You are listening to Off Planet Radio at offplanetradio.com.
Hello. So first, I'm going to express what I'm not going to do. I'm not going to tell you truth. I don't care for truth. Truth is from the trough. It is everyone's perspective. I don't care for perspectives, opinions, versions, or any other buzzwords like freedom and other nonsense that people have come to believe in and hope for. What I am going to do is straightforwardly, admittedly, tell you stories. I am a storyteller. I'm going to tell you things that will add a narrative line to your story. If you feel like that's intruding, interfering, imposing, intimidating, you should stop listening now. But I'm not sure that you don't feel those things because you have no idea who you are. You have no idea where you are. Despite listening to voluminous amounts of data, given copious amounts of thought, you may still have no concept. I'm going to make, during this talk, outlandish statements, even for those coming from the so-called alternative truth community, which I equally don't care for. Although I am quite aware of it. I know Randy very well. I don't know his audience, but I do have experience with hearing the material of his guests. So I have an expectancy of material that the audience I'm speaking to should be familiar with. You and I are living fictional lives currently. However, they're being carried out in a nonfiction. Let that sink in. You are living a fictional life and a nonfiction. What I'm also going to do is contradict myself continually, apparently, but not at all. And so meaning a living paradox. We live in layers. And if those layers aren't continually sorted and tended, then we live in lies. What I'm going to do tonight is tell you what I know. First, I could tell you my name. I could tell you all my names, and I gladly will. But I'm going to tell you who I am. I am in charge. Rather bold and audacious statement. But it's what I know. The fullness of what that means will be revealed as things progress. Tonight I'm not here to tell you anything. While I have stored in my local and non-local vaults copious amounts of information. What I'm not is a whistleblower. There are no whistles to blow. The only people who actually care are people who are not people. They're individuals who already, across a spectrum of awareness, already know. And for those of us who are, this other species, we get very neurologically excited, very set on edge when data is revealed of a critical nature. But we already basically knew it, one manner or another of knowing it. There is no whistleblowing. I'm not here to make friends with the alternative community. I'm not here to tell anything outside of my story. But the act of telling my story is neither for me nor for it to be known in some simple sense. And it's certainly not to give you more details. Tonight I'm doing something. What I'm doing is accelerating the quickening. The content that I'm putting forward will resonate with a very select few. And for those few, we all need to find each other. And we have things to do. Going out with this talk, with this interview, will trigger many things for me, for you, and for the overall climate, the overall existence in which we each are and are together in. So we'll have an impact for every being. I'm going to simplify this and begin telling you stories. Stories from my fiction. Currently, I am most generally called by others in reference to myself, Z.
This is Off Planet Radio recording Saturday, November 14th, 2015. We are on the line with Z, and we are going to begin the conversation fluidly and wherever you want to go.
Okay, Randy. So I want to speak to some of what I said in the intro, and that is concerning a fiction that when I say I'd rather relate to things spoken of as a story. I don't mean that in the sense oftentimes that people want to use a story to hide behind or to suggest that they're not saying what they're saying, so they're not pursued by some agency, but rather that we really can't do much with words that are not, in a sense, lies, that words themselves lie. They represent a fiction. And that's what I mean, that we have no real ability here with each other other than storytelling.
Right. Well, that's actually the great tradition of mythology, mythology is basically encoded wisdom inside of a story that allows it to penetrate the consciousness.
And in that effect, I have the luxury of being nobody. Nobody on the circuit of somebodies who want to be somebodies, and I don't care to be somebody. I care to say something that will set things further in motion and be a frequency that will continue to gather in those who are de-sneaking each other at this time.
Right, what we've basically referred to as possibly a gathering, or I think you've called it the quickening.
The ancient Gaelic, the Celt, the Norse tradition would refer to it as a quickening, which implies both an acceleration of vibrations and a coming together, and in some ways, more importantly, the coming together. Because there's, at the end of getting through the message I intend to deliver, I've been charged to deliver, there are very few who will not be put off by it in some minor or major manner, and that's okay, because it's for the few. Even the avatar Yeshua said that the gate is narrow and few are those who pass through. So there is a elect, a contingent left who are here to do some work together. And that work isn't done for themselves, but rather for everybody. And that isn't a salvationist statement. I feel, especially in light of your recent work, that's an important nuance to that. This is not a salvationist statement. It's rather just an effect of the way things are set up, that there is work to be done in stages of increments and ripples. And, of course, that work has been being done for aeons, and that in itself is difficult to say because it's all being done. It's all being done now. Just we live in layers, as I mentioned, so we can get situated at a certain point in those layers, like we are now, and believe in that fiction. But not to believe in that fiction simultaneously is to also be confused, because our fictional lives have power. They're not an illusion. Maybe it would be fair to have called it a delusion. The difference being that in a delusion, you're unsure, you're unclear of what you're interacting with, but what you're interacting with is very real. You're just in a kind of a delirium, a delusion of concerning it, rather than an illusion to say it's not nothing. It's not nothing.
Yeah, the words kind of almost tangle us up sometimes, too, when we're trying to talk about this, because these are concepts that are, again, multi-layered.
Mm-hmm. So it might be fair to bring up something you said when we had met back in face-to-face finally back in a month ago, that it's not what we know, and it's not even to a certain extent what we do, which is not a statement of non-accountability, but rather it's what we are. It's what we are that is bringing on
right,
what is to
right.
be.
It is our, it's our energetic, it's our own gravity within the creational realm, and the reason why we came in at this time. And that's actually one of the defining things about this, is that the people who will hear this and it will resonate with are the people who have that sense that they came here for a specific purpose in this particular dimensional realm of space and time. So it is about what we are. And then it is about secondarily, and you can feel free to disagree with this, secondarily, it is about what we do, but what we do is defined by who we are.
That is exactly what I mean. And what we do has major ramifications, and that doing is micro moment by micro moment of awareness. We have these, as I heard someone you're speaking with recently put it, hamster wheels, nice term, that are built in everywhere to grab functions. You know, if you use a computer idea, there's processes that are running ad infinitum. They're running in loops and cycles, and they are taking up a ton of the CPU use. They're using a ton of available resources, and that's distracting and interfering with the ability to be and do clearly everything we are. And it was well said in that same vein in the recent Jupiter Ascending movie. He says, you know, the character played by Mila Kunis says, well, you know, if you knew what I did here, you wouldn't be so sure that I was the queen of existence, one way to put it. And he said afterwards, my lady, it's not what you do, it's who you are. Meaning, not in the sense that what our actions amount to in integrity, because that is very important, but rather what you do in this fiction in some ways is just that. It's a fiction. In the movies, for instance, she was a janitor, she was a house cleaner, mm-hmm. with a family of house cleaners. But she was hidden here as one of the queens of heaven, so to speak. So in that sense, it's not what we do in this fiction, because I'm nobody of importance to anybody on this level. However, my speaking, coming forward at all, will trigger great peril for many of us, for me, and because of who I am and what my frequency carries. There is a most upper tier of what's running things, very non-corporeal entities that I would use the Koine Greek term ekthroi, simply means enemies. The Writers of the Dead Sea Scrolls, the Essenes, use these terms, as well, along with archons. Archons is a more particular form of the ekthroi, but the ekthroi in general, the enemies of reality. They seek a great oblivion, which cannot occur, technically, but that's what they're seeking. And it comes down to the more familiar, known versions of things on our local level of so-called Luciferians and their agendas. But in the primordial version of things, there is a desire by these entities for oblivion, which generates the such much known about and oft talked about Saturnic cults, or the black hole sun cult, the oblivion cult. And they seek to keep us from remembering who we are and what it is to be a human.
Yeah, that's one of those conscious keys that I keep coming back to. And I seem to hit it whenever I get discouraged or depressed or overtired. It comes back to the original point, which is remember who you are.
And then the secondary point, what we're doing because of who we are, which flows very naturally.
Yeah, it all flows kind of together, but it's an important point because it's the one that we keep getting disassociated from.
Mm-hmm. The same guest you were speaking to, you referred to Pavlov and how these things were very Pavlovian, and they are. And most of those of us here, even who are something more than the peripheral masses, are also sometimes getting stuck in these Pavlovian responses at all different levels, be they bodily, social cues, or even interior mind-based and soul-based responses or reactions.
Yeah, just look at the engineering that goes into the media. Here, we're recording this on Saturday, November 14th, yesterday in Paris, you had a terrorist strike. And it was clearly a defined media event because it was all over the social media and the regular media almost instantaneously. And of course, the would-be as if president came on to the national media and, you know, whatever he said, it doesn't matter. He just, you know, his words speak. But the, my point is that these events jump into our consciousness and it pulls everybody over onto the visceral level, drops the frequencies, and everybody jumps on board, which is exactly the point of what these media events ultimately are supposed to do. It has less to do with the information than the frequencies that they are expending in order to keep us distracted.
Definitely. And of course, it was notably Friday the 13th and the month of 11. They like their numbers.
Yeah, yeah, no Illuminati signatures there at all.
Of course. So for us, working this out, or the outworking, is, you know, maybe give it a theological theme, is building narrative. Because in building narrative, we are able to re-empower ourselves, and that narrative is to be built cautiously and carefully, wanting always to center to our core, to be who we are, and to fully express ourselves. And the very, as you know, you put visceral level of this is where it will always need to come back to, that we can slow ourselves down. And we don't always have to respond to even to the most minor social cues. And there's a number of directions I could branch off to on that. In these so-called fictional lives that we're walking in, there are dangers that are not always seen, where you have cult members, so to, you know, one way to refer to them, that often themselves are in unawares. They're unclear as to what they're doing, much like they can be dropped into what I've heard termed appendaged bodies. They can be dropped into like Agent Smith in the Matrix. And there's a plethora of different attachments and aggravants and stress vectors that can be added through them, or classic forms of handlers, and now with all the technotronic weaponry, to just make what we're experiencing as everyday life nearly impossible with the degree of pressure. And it's, you know, just to understand that it all comes down to what we on a visceral level in the fiction would experience as endocrine responses, that we are curing ourselves ultimately at the actual seat of the soul. Definitely be feedback for saying this live, but it's the hippocampus, not the pineal. The hippocampus is the seat of the soul. It's very near the pineal gland. They work together. And with that driving faculty there, everything is linked through to the pituitary gland and into the endocrine system and through our lymph veins, and then neurologically stimulated back. And everything is concerning what would be called emotions. I'd rather use the term feelings, since emotion is just an outgoing response. So it has the E there. But the feelings, our feeling-based systems, another representation is very much in the five-season series fringe. The entire series is a representation of some Enochian characters who were, so, you know, supposedly beyond, you know, presented as being beyond time and space. In the end, what they've lost, and we've heard this story many times in many ways, what they've lost is their ability to be in the feeling zone, the mammalian zone. They're strictly working off a mathematical cerebral cortex, sort of left brain, so-called left brain version of themselves. They're not linked to their core. And we have this in our one manifestation that this is related to as the so-called gray aliens, these interdimensional robots, whatever you want, these archontic
characters
that run around and manipulate things. They're sort of a micro version of this. We have the cultural expression, the caretakers of the Matrix. But it would all dovetail nicely into the recent series the Wachowskis did called Sense8.
Yeah,
you know,
sure.
Where we step back into asking the question that the character Jonas asks. He says, what is it to be human? If to be human is to experience, essentially paraphrased, then those who are part of the so-called Sense8 are the actual humans. They're experiencing at a much higher, much more advanced level. So that term is actually a term of power, and there may not actually at the end of the day be so many humans who are actually, it may be abrasive and offensive to many listening, but many of you listeners, you might not actually be alive. That may sound ridiculous to you, but you might be robots. That goes into some, what you said. How would a robotic intelligence know it was a robot?
You just said you may not be alive. Is that correct? In other words, you may be living as a biological entity in some form, but not alive in the sense of the what we would call vivisence, the spark.
Well, I would refer anybody who hasn't looked at the work of Nigel Kerner to do so. So I wouldn't go into it myself, but I espouse the same things as I heard him espousing for a long time.
Yeah.
And there are many here who are part of what might be referred to as a silicon soul, a archontic soul, a undifferentiated, unrealized version of soul, thus making it non-soul. But it does not say that it's not a position of unworth or degradement, but rather it's just not yet. They're unrealized. They're a form, some primordial state that Nigel details very well that needs to be handled with care so that it can come to be realized. But currently, it isn't. And it is emanations from the root of this undifferentiated form that is generating all the tears into T-I-E-R, the tears, the layers down that we're experiencing as separation, or some call duality, this fractured and fraction state that we exist in, is because there are a portion of us who are from an original different state than that merged into this separation situation in order to heal it. So much of what we're experiencing is, simply put, artificial. But then artificial is not necessarily ultimately fake. It's rather, simply put, an artifice.
Can we say it's a replication?
Sure. Exactly. And that opens doors, literally opens doors and portals to a number of conversations.
That's what jumped into my head when you said that.
We're with folks in this time-space situation, whatever you want to call what we're existing in now, and there's all players who are using substances, chemicals, to have a recreational, escaping, divine, whatever kind of experience they're seeking from them, from hallucinogenics especially, to a variety of things that act on what's locally experienced as the brain and brain chemistry. They're opening portals. Just again, go back to internet and computer metaphor. And but the real picture that, you know, might want to get in folks' mind, their corpus callosum now, they're viewing things, is the movie series Hellraiser. These are
wow. Yeah, I'm gonna have to go back and look at that with new eyes.
There are these. It's almost like a Rubik's cube. When you take these substances that have been formed on a chemical level, their geometry is such that you're giving permission for entities formed along that molecular geometry. It's a contract. Mm-hmm. You're allowing them to come through your, if you go back to internet, you know, networking terms, your back doors. We're now into a certain form of vampirism. And what that is, you're allowing this leeching to happen. So that's always a compromising situation with any psychoactive substance. Maybe if we were all in the, what we call in this relative local sense, if we were all at the level of shaman, maybe we could go in there and deal with demons. But, you know, in all fairness, not everyone is qualified to be in there. And it's generating quite a effect that's manifesting into transmogrifying the organic, so-called organic format that we started out here in. And not even to say that that is all sacred, untouchable, pure, but it is a starting ground.
Well, and that's actually what is happening. If you look right now at the research that's coming out in a lot of different disciplines, actually Harold Caltavella talks about this in the book that he wrote with Kara St. Louis, where he talks about these crystalline... Dangerous Imagination, Silent Assimilation, thank you. And he talks about these crystalline forms that are being... These forms, what we're learning now, these forms are actually energetic forms. They are actually forming off of electromagnetic frequencies, interacting even with Wi-Fi devices and other types of personal devices. And we're getting these crystalline entities that ultimately seem to be manifesting in these weird spider-like microbe entities that then manifest into things like Morgellons. So what you just talked about there is, you know, the archontic environment being invaded by man and then manifested back out into physical reality. Transmogrify is probably the best term you can use for that.
Yeah, and some of what was laid out there, the observable phenomena of being able to see things back, rolling back, I guess, if we were to use computer terminology again, to being from the trinary layer to a binary operative.
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm.
That, you know, we see that there's a ton of interference. That's what we're getting. So if we again relate this binary response react system to this sort of Pavlovian, just to speak that out for anybody who's unclear, that's a simple thing to express. It's, you know, the scientist Pavlov did the famous experiments with dogs where he rang a bell and associated that to receiving a treat of some kind, and they would know to ring the bell to get the treat. So it's a series of associations, and it's not, there's no need to retain it at being that unsophisticated. They're extremely sophisticated associations, what might often be called mental gymnastics or series of, you know, psychological complexes. It weaves through a whole network of things, like people sitting around cerebrally absorbing information from the alternative media. Going through a bunch of cerebral hoops. And some of them are useful. Some of them trigger us to remember, and some of them are hamster wheels.
Yeah, I would say that most of them are hamster wheels, to be quite honest with you. And, you know, I say that knowing that I participate in that in some level at times, because I think we all do it. But the distraction level is so high that we get, you know, again, we get pulled right off of the R-ness that we are into this whole other area where the lower frequencies start to, again, impact our conscious state.
Definitely. And that's, you know, what came up inside of there, you know, well, there you have narrative, where narrative is being built on top of other narrative, and we start to understand the nature of our fiction, that there is no fiction in the sense that we, in the linear sense, would refer to fiction. There is a ability to build a clarifying toward what we are, and that can be interfered with. So, coming back again to this idea of interference, and that original interference on many levels is due to a primordial error that I've dubbed Murphy's Law. This, in a kidding but very genuine sense, this goes to the original state of being. And to, and just to skip forward through that, what we went, what those who have, who went into that separation field to begin to heal it, it's a constant flux of interference, because everything is happening in this qualitative instant called now. But then there are many segments that come out of that, because we are in a separation. So if we're looking back to where I brought up Hellraiser, so there's a sort of, again, an effect of opening portals through, to some degree, we could use the term Einstein-Rosen bridges, microtubule wormholes. We're floating through a bunch of information and sectors of information that there arise in the entropy entities that want to have power over other things and continue to maintain this interference for the entities from which this process was began. Again, reference back to Nigel Kerner's work, so I don't have to trace through all that. But I'm relating and referring and alluding to many movies, and there's a function of our current linear state that might look at that and say, well, those are just movies, you know, those are somewhat trite. But I feel your audience has at least been exposed to the idea of what the elite and the negative, the dark magicians, the shadow magicians would call mandate, meaning the truth needs to be anchored somewhere, needs to be parked somewhere. Oh, I shouldn't even say truth, but the facts need to be anchored somewhere. And in so, they have cleaned their hands, as their processes would say. They've cleaned their hands of it because it's out there. And they have a mandate to disclose that, not because they're good boys and girls, so to speak, they want to play by the rules, but rather it's not because of any rules at all. More a rule in the sense of a mechanism, that their goal, their end goal, everybody asks, well, what's the end goal? What's the end goal? Their end goal is the desire for oblivion. And that goes back to their primordial state of affairs, and what they, why they want that. But they're all the trickle down to the players and the roles on the local scene. They desire oblivion, and in such, if they were to usurp the will of another being, they would incur what we could loosely call karma. So it's not that they're behaving and they don't want to break the rule. It's rather that they would defy or displace a mechanism that, if, as though it were possible to attain oblivion, it's not, but if it were, they would disrupt that and they would not achieve their goal, which is why they play by the rules, so to speak. These functions that do exist, they stay in check with them because of what they hope to attain. The situation is far more bleak, however, because they're in a pure demented delirium. There's no ability to achieve oblivion. In fact, what they would end up doing is an everlasting destruction, where things will continue to fragment indefinitely, generating full infinity, an infinite shattering, which is a segue into what I hope to be able, with any detail, to contribute, which is a exposure full-on foray into examining and knowing of the cult of the bath by that term.
Yeah, bath. Explain that now. Explain what that is exactly, because a lot of people may not know about that. I didn't originally when we started talking.
Well, I have had, and again, even speaking in tense is funny, but I've had great clarity pretty much since I was born, and understanding the primordial situation. It's what it's been for me is a journey of piecing back together the more local relative situation. So I have many who have spoken to thank for triggering things to remember. But as a word, B-A-P-H, bath, is related to baptism, or just simply bath. It's a submergence. And ultimately, I can quickly, coherently assemble this. It would be a submergence in the black goo at its highest level.
Oh, boy.
And what we're dealing with is if you walk into the Enochian literature, any of the Sumerian texts, and with eyes to see, with the keys to read through any of the ancient texts, we're dealing with entities that are operating on a so-called genetic level. But then that asks the question to go deeper, that what are genes? I would say they're soul, which is distinct from spirit. They're a manifestation of soul, which is why the ancients would say pray to their ancestors. Why we have a genetic crisis, why things in the financial world have sought to patent, copyright gene code, and then individual gene code to associate them to financial instruments, to loop that back through their lovely barcodes. So then those who are here doing this hamster wheel job-based activity, going to work for the system, and then they get paid a little bit out each week, day, month, biweekly, whatever. Then take their little representative cash and they go back and they buy products with a barcode that links it directly back to their what they're putting into the economy. It's a really ingenious, insidious system that has been developed more recently. Of course, the patent holders are the usual suspects, the puppets for these entropial forces. But the cult of the bath itself is working off on a surface level that, which is, you know, you could quickly conjure up the images in the first matrix of understanding that there are people being used as batteries. Because on the deeper level, that's what's being pulled, is the etheric energy that's drawn out of keeping everyone in a cycle where they're discombobulated and always preoccupied. And as we go through the deeper layers of it and begin to enter those who are directly in the cult at one level or another, from mind control programs to those who engage in ritual sacrifice and all different components that go with that from every angle, at its highest level of the order, where we will see these very, very rubric-like genetic things happening. On a local level, it might look very messy. I have a very close friend who really helped me to get through certain layers of this, and even understanding the occulted nature of my birth name. We're dealing with, for those who are way inside, a layer of design, of designer reality, that there is genetic swapping, and just anything can be swapped out, in almost in the sense of like magnetic poetry. There's whole, I mean, if we were to go into the side of those who have been in programs, there are some of us who don't even have parents. You know, we were genetically designed. We were designer DNA. What the so-called they discovered was, if you arrange alleles in a certain sequence that you would, by necessity, bring back the soul that corresponded to that pattern. So in that effect, soul is pattern. And then pattern as logos or memra. In the Aramaic memra and the Koine Greek logos, these patterns of numbers, of letters, of symbols, sequences. And this is their cult. This is their way of assembling things. It's almost like playing the game of Sims, the Sims game. This is a giant Sims game. And there, you know, there's numerous folks who have expressed this, and maybe some more extravagant so-called New Age ways, or, you know, they're saying the same thing. I'm not sure they're all aware of what they're saying exactly, but this is an assembly of parts, because that's what soul has been reduced to. And the only healing for soul is to fully integrate spirit, because spirit has the ability to parse through all those layers and heal them. So again, I'm going to coherently come back through that, take another swipe through that. So the way that that does not occur, coming back again to these layers of interference, is if spirit is scared off, because relating through these anthropomorphic terms, these emotional, but they work. If spirit becomes traumatized or scared off, then, and you know, a ton of this framework, I can give credit to Steve Richards, the Aboriginal expositor, for laying out these terms, but the terms work, they're well said.
Yeah, they do.
I don't want to act as if they're my own. I definitely have direct experience with them, but I'm going to use his terms and give him credit because they make sense. And when spirit is traumatized, then it does not integrate with soul. And the swipe back through that I want to make is to pedophilia. So when we understand what this layer of the fiction is being contained in a body, and at this stage, it's trapped in a body. And bodies are not meant to be a trap. I'm going to just slightly mention that the layer that we're living in, and the having of bodies, and this material world that we exist in, which is not the physical world, but the material world in this holograph, is actually a pinnacle of an artistic track back to wholeness and harmony. It isn't functioning like that now. It's functioning as a prison. The prisons, with an M, the prisons that we're seeing each other through are being used to isolate us in this separation field and being used as a prison. It's not meant to be. So currently, these bodies, these vessels, are trapping soul in a way that it does not, that it can become essentially raped and disempowered. So if we move to that theme of pedophilia, why is that so prevalent? It's actually very simple. Most of these things are, if you can traumatize the totally innocent and unable, you know, defenseless entity called a child, the hope is through these bloodlines, or the, again, I'm going to reference another individual, Paul Levy, who so well laid out the condition of what the indigenous North Americans would call Wendigo or Waitiko, that there is a sickness, a dis-ease that's running through the collective conscious, because those even who are the those who have come in, let's say, to heal, are still inside of this great entropy, this great separation field, and we all collect the sickness. Might be some bodhisattvic like task to pick up and these shadows and metabolize them into wholeness. But locally, why pedophilia? Because you have a defenseless child. That's how it's manifesting. That soul is trapped in the form of defenseless child. If you can traumatize especially specific children, but any children, to such an extent that their spirit can never heal, or become scooted off from this trauma that the soul is taking, and they can never marry each other, well, we are rendered impotent. We're rendered entirely impotent. And this is seen, you know, very easily seems into the cults, into the mind control programs, into those who were raised in whatever term you want to give, so-called Luciferian homes, and those who were practicing these tortures and traumas. If, you know, even mindlessly and amnesia, or even doing so with full knowledge, they were doing so, but maybe until you get to very, very high tiers, levels of this, not fully conceptualizing what's actually going on. But the simplicity of why pedophilia is because you're bringing the most possible layer of fear and trauma to a trapped soul. And in that vein, it will never link appropriately with its spirit. And then it will never have the power to edit or augment and affect change within this fiction so that it can become the world to come that any dreamer would, you know, desire, the blissful harmony that this entire existence was set out on its course for.
So that's one level of it. This obviously goes into mind control programs and other trauma-based assaults on consciousness. Do you want to kind of move into that at all?
Sure. I mean, that's my fiction. That's my story.
Yeah.
I grew up in Connecticut, New England, here in the USA. And it's really only recently that, you know, I fully concluded that my so-called parents loved me in their own way and reconciled that, because back engineering and understanding of parts of the world around me, my family would be very, very strange, very, very strange people. And I went through many different traumas as a child, just within the fiction. I don't relate to it like that, it's simpler. And somewhat recently continued to follow a trajectory of confirmations. My father's father was the Grand Master of a very prominent lodge, not the Masons, but they're up there. There's one large confirmation. And the other side is prominently Prussians. Tie quickly into a ton of things that others have been speaking about and needing to draw attention to, which opens the whole can of worms into the Khazarians. And the other part of the Khazarians, and who the Prussians are, the Bavarians, or the High Transylvanians. So that part of my family were all High Transylvanians. And this is a life of interference, constantly knowing you're on a mission to live your life in such a way of integrity, to become something, to attain clarity, but constantly being interfered with, incessantly interfered with. Familiar?
I'm with you.
So for me, there's a point where I woke up again. I remember being very awake as a child, and I know many of us do or have that experience of being very connected. I know for me and for many it was through nature, seeing things through nature. And 7 years old, 8 years old, 9 years old, these seem to be pivotal years at which we get put back to sleep. They know who we are. They know where we are. I should say it knows where we are, because ultimately we're talking about an eye through all its layers of what we're just walking through. And it through its agencies knows where we are. And the most micro fractions of skewing can be generated. But my experience when I began to come back awake, I suppose, was around 15. I grew up in my mother's side is a Jewish family predominantly, and my father is a predominantly Catholic, and he found his way to evangelical circles, and then it all sort of came together around the so-called Messianic Jewish movement. And I grew up with around some very formidable theologians and divinity scholars. This provided a backdrop to look and examine some of these things. And, you know, the prophets of the world are very instructive, not necessarily the religions or the dogmas that spring up around them, but the prophets themselves. And for me, it was encountering the prophet Daniel in the book of Daniel and the interesting prophecies that he suggests and how accurate they were and dated to their time period within this historical fiction. That was the beginning, and I was 15, of a whole process of waking again. And even though it seemed like maybe 40 years passed between there, was only two till I was 17, and a whole number of things had occurred in between there, and I entered to interactions with a particular rabbi. This rabbi is, well, I'm not sure what to term to use to refer to him, but he's definitely not human. That'd be the greatest brevity I can provide to that. Is in his late 80s. In the fiction, at the time I began interacting with him, but he's currently still alive and 102 years old.
What do you think, he was like a golem or something?
Oh, no. See, yeah. A golem is a sort of brainless entity, a sort of proto-robot. I mean, you could cue some of the Joseph Farrell work on that. And
maybe what I was trying to get at was like a, I don't know, some sort of cyborg. I'm trying to find some term.
More like a creature.
Creature.
You know, I mean, a friend of ours would call these leaders of covens or even parents. But you know, there's a spectrum along lines that he has defined to hardlined. He's one of the managers, if you will, managers of the. You might look at him as an architect of this ulterior destiny that is desire, this oblivion field. So I went to him by some calling. Now, there's a logistical story too, but you know, in the course of this, he'd been around and part of a dysfunctionally falling apart synagogue. Again, for me, much of this is back engineered, these details, and through the concourse of coming to know him, I encountered another individual who became very involved in my life. And as the years passed on, this was 1997, and as the years passed on, it became clear to me that he had always been involved in my life and was in fact a handler for me.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, it's funny how that pops up later on. These people No, it's just consistent narrative that these people pop in and out, but somehow they break the continuity so that your memories are fragmented until you suddenly remember and start to connect those threads that this person had a presence beyond just, you know, the occasional.
Definitely. In the fiction, as I keep referring to it, he's in his 70s, coming on his mid-70s. He's a Catholic deacon and had a number of interesting little connections to a number of different things, and he was very brazen. He is very brazen. We have stopped speaking again. I've stopped speaking to him now for a number of reasons. Even since it was in fall of 2011 that I noted, it came to me. It just flashed, and I really got the picture. And it was shortly after that I actually found you, Randy, through listening to a clip you did with Duncan as regarded the fellow Brock Brader when all that came out. But all that kind of came in a confluence of occurrences inside for me in 2011. But until that point, I've been having a long-standing back and forth with this individual. and I could very easily just call him W, which is the first initial of his name, and also the deep Illuminati significance, but let's call him W. And he was very brazen. He would very, very brazenly say cryptic things that yet sounded like exactly what they were. And as I would dissect them over the course of our, you know, whatever, 17-year relationships on the surface, I would speak them back to him, and he would sort of glaze over, and I just took this to be some sort of a obnoxious behavior where he wouldn't relate or answer what I was asking. And it wasn't until the last few years that I began to understand fully what amnesia spells are, which are even beyond compartmentalization of alters, in the sense that there is an appendaged body, as I've called it, as I've heard it called, that would step in and do things, but he has no idea about it. So in the typical fictional character that he is, that walks around and lives his life as the manager of a large industrial plant and a Catholic deacon, and now in a aficionado of Judaism and obviously a family father and husband, he doesn't know this level of himself. So I do sound strange repeating back things he himself has said, but he's unaware of them, except at a very abstract level. But those things themselves that were said continued to reveal a track, and I was open and willing to follow this track, perhaps because of a programmed level of command to obey suggestion, particularly from this individual. But they always yielded interesting things, and I would now in retrospect look back and note that because of how I am and who I am, they never went the way, and I'm sure you, Randy, from our talk can relate to this, they never went the way the cult would have wanted them to. Each thing that was put in my path to affect something they desired as an outcome generally failed.
Yeah. It's just like it backfires or inverts somehow. It's like a blowback.
Oftentimes, horridly for them, and because, like yourself, I was never able to be fully programmed.
Assimilated.
And in effect, some of what, when I opened myself to looking back and seeing what was going on, what I began to see is I was a very particular individual in this fiction of the programs, and is actually at a certain point kicked out and re-brought back on because I took out a bunch of agents. That was a very prominent memory I had because of a certain layer of what we are. There are some of us here who are what I term the third tier of the anomaly, and the AI itself doesn't understand. It doesn't know what to do. And that's not putting us in the role again. We're not able just to be directly saviors. It's not going to all just work out, but it will give us a fair shake. It will allow the actual humanity to have finally the opportunity to generate a field soon where we are not interfered with and we can deal with this on an even plane. Which doesn't mean we win. It means we get to give it a shot.
Yeah.
And in that vein, one of the major things that began to happen locally, and I'm not really sure just how far back it goes, but it certainly goes back at least as far as the 70s. Probably late 60s at least, maybe before, by dozens of confirmed reports, is all the local genetic tampering, attempting to be like these entities of beyond. And, you know, we have cloning programs, but even more so, something I've very, very rarely heard the briefest mention of is a track that was undertaken called, it would be, you know, cryogenic freezing of children. That was done because it was caught on that there was, if I could jump to say the terms of Nietzsche, the ideation of eternal recurrence, where you have a vessel, a soul vessel, a potentiality that you can become. And it doesn't necessarily mean you become it, that you can become it if you step into and empower the role. You have the ability to be it, but then you must also be it. This kind of goes back to the beginning. You are what you are, but you also must do it. You could even tie this into some of the Apostle Paul's work on grace and works. I mean, you know, this is a dichotomy of the core interior of what the code is and what the code becomes. And in this vein, they discovered that there was, at the fullness of the anomaly, a set of plans, if you will, a set of its own patterns, counter patterns, that would manifest in our fictional, casual, everyday life in a way that children born would find each other at very opportune and auspicious moments of their life to gain and actualize potency. So, in effect, what the only thing they could come up with to do was to sort of stagger this by cryogenically freezing them. This gets to a root here, that there are certain ones of us who don't ever have to really be concerned, at least about being killed, maybe tortured, but they need us alive because our very essence is running certain things. But they couldn't just kill them. They knew that. They know some of us they made, some of us they formed. But then when those souls, because again, I kind of cut this off as I was saying it, but when you align a bunch of alleles, you generally bring on a forced reincarnation. And as these souls came back, they understood their nature, that they were very, very powerful, and that there was something even more than the layer of when they had lived, say, in Egypt or Atlantis or Lemuria, this other place, this other culture, very, very obscurely referenced, called the Lyrans. The Allurians. I just said that word on air. That itself is enough to... Anyhow. But there's a way that they understood that what they could do was stagger this, and it would generate an effect where our lives would be screwed up from the get-go. We would not be meeting each other at auspicious moments, and preferably we would not be meeting each other at all. However, what we see in this quickening, in this ingathering that's been happening intensely, and it's been happening for decades, but it's been happening intensely in the last, say, 7 years. I'm picking a number, 20 years.
Yeah, that's actually pretty good. Pretty good zen for that 7 years. I buy that.
Maybe it's, you know, 2003 or somewhere around there, 2002, 2004, when you have the convergence. But it's been accelerating and accelerating and accelerating, and we are finding each other, because what's inside us is magnetized toward each other in a resonance field, and we are finding each other. And that's, you know, that talks, that gets into more of what the solution is with us doing things that are, I don't like the term because of how it's been misused, but sustainable, and because coming together and generating a sustainable experience of the community together, a living community, actively living in these bodies and these visceral ships together in these temples, can have the effect of sending things back on the vectors they need out of separation and into integrity. But that's moving away from this particular understanding. As unfortunately, the deeper down in the rabbit hole we are, the more tangents and scattered trajectories there are that really do come back around. But this was an experience that I came to understand I had gone through. I was essentially born twice, and I said in the introduction I was going to make outlandish statements, but this is part of the cult of the bath. I was born to a older daughter of the family, but even then I was designed, and my batch, my birth name was Brian spelled, and I said it exactly how the cult would like to say it, Brian, as in brine shrimp, as in a batch of a brine, but it's spelled in the Gaelic way, B-R-I-E-N, so it could easily have this permutation. And our batch, and again, this kind of is some of what is being referred to in Sensate by Jonas, he's talking about the batches. That there are, this is this is what all the little yummy super soldiers won't talk about. But we're genetically designed to, and this is the wallop that scared our mutual friend away when I said the plan is to bring down the high kings and queens. So if you queue up Lord of the Rings, Aragorn, and several others, and understanding Sumerian culture, that they're bringing back the high kings and queens. Mm-hmm. And going to, as our friend Duncan would say, I'm going to be in a lot of trouble for saying these things. And that's okay. I've been waiting to get myself in a lot of trouble. But that is what they were doing, and most of us were assigned to families that were deep cult families, mostly in Ignami, in the middle of nowhere, sometimes with more and less wealth and resources, sometimes with none, sometimes with just totally poor families with no context or anything. And this is so, I keep not finishing the idea, but they basically staggered, again, these, like the cryogenic freezing people. The longest case I knew was 7 years. I know for myself it was 2 years before each one was in vitro, and so is born, literally born, to one, and then disassembled. This gets into the cult of the bath again, and things that might be backstage. You were working at a theme park, you go backstage and get disassembled and put together as another character. And there's the factuality and the implementation of this is so extensive. It's staggering, and most people are going to just gloss over and go into a very deep cognitive dissonance as they say these things as actually what's going on. That at any moment, anywhere, using the various janitorial staff, these
well, that's a colorful way to describe them, but I like it.
That's kind of what they are.
Yeah,
you
yeah.
Send in the cleaners. You know, if you go X-Files on it, you send in the cleaners. And, you know, they could pull you out and literally dismantle your body, dismantle parts of the substance that makes up mind. They can change things and augment things everywhere to the extent that you have not made yourself immaculately impenetrable and impeccable. So there's, you know, this is another thing, another word of advice to the so-called alternative truth community. Everything is situated in the extent of your integrity, in the integrity of your practices. Again, this is back toward the solution. Practices, you know, it's not just a cerebral amassment of data, because that can just be manipulated everywhere. But
go into a little more depth on what you mean by that when you say the practices.
What, you know, I mean, practices that we have had from time immemorial, say even the simplest things, breathing practices, meditation practices of all kinds, you know, how you conduct yourself through your day and beyond ethics, certainly beginning with ethics, but then there's an ethics of expedience that goes beyond that. I know for myself, living in this body is tricky. We are called to be neuroendocrine ninjas. You know, when you're black magicians, unless you're suddenly awakened and find yourself in some, you know, basement and there's some weird cult ritual going on, demons, so-called demons and black magicians do not present themselves as big scary creatures. They're going to manifest in front of your coffee at Starbucks. But more so that it's a frequency of interference in the atmosphere around the visceral vessel, the body, the temple, that are coming through everywhere as you're sitting and drinking your coffee from, I guess I'd drop the term in that I'm surprised I haven't used yet, the vectors. And so what we have, and I know I also cut myself off ways back and finished the notion of these sacred geometrical forms way back when I was speaking about people using substances here. We're existing on fractals. You know, when you said replication, that's what it was. You mentioned the idea of replication. Well, it would have to be because the existence that we're flowing through now at all different tiers is even to what would be called the physical world, that some would call the astral world. I'd rather just call it the physical world because that's what it is, where the physics is composed. via these is a world of replication. That's what fractals do. Fractals just replicate themselves. Unfortunately, to use the term that is used by Diane Lupa in the somewhat classic ET101, said this is a place, this Midgard, this Earth plane is a place where we've raised the dysfunction to an art form. So some sit around on these substances and are moored and enraptured with all the colorful fractals, not understanding that the very fact that fractals just simply replicate is itself demonic. Because that's all demonic layers and exploit layers can do, is usurp and rape and steal and take and co-opt things from the original beings who actually have the power of creation, real magic. They can just absorb, just like the programs did with us as children. They're just sitting there, Project Talent, Project Steal Your Talent, and all these other names, that they're just usurping abilities to generate their artificial versions. So that's all that's going on. We have fractals, these fractal beings that are replicating, moving furniture, I like to put it like moving furniture around. And in one of the deep Kabbalistic texts, say for Yetzirah, they would explain the form of Yotzer. Yotzer means the forming versus a Briya, which is actually creating something. They don't create anything. They just form and reform like clay, like so much clay. That's, you know, your Adamu, your Enkidu, all these different little beings that they've made here are like so much Play-Doh.
I want to go back for a second, though, because of what you said earlier about the fact that these entities, these black magicians and these dark entities are not normally manifesting, and I'm really trying to reconstruct the way you said it, in the overt way that we see them, but in fact they're very subtle in their occurrence and implementation.
Well, let me relate to that through a more approachable framework. Say the backroom strategies of governments, you know, and on the political scene, on the political social scene. So if there were things that were put out overtly that this is what we're doing and it's terrible and horrible and everybody ready to sign up, then of course people would say no. So instead you have, you know, everybody from Esther Brooks back to Watson and right back to Galton himself and all these wonderful, terrible these monsters and the great Bernard. Edward Bernays and Bernard Lipton, you know, masking all these things underneath some form of desirable something. So in the same vein, you know, if you were to put, if the so-called demons...
Do you mean like subliminals? Is that what you're...
Yeah, well, it's a subliminal thing, but it's more than that. It's in the social level. You have these huge social schemas that have been dropped on the visceral entity living in the fiction, and so they conduct their lives according to social trends and social manipulation, which have been, of course, those who know that they've been designed to by the beings with vastly, you know, capable intellects at so-called think tanks and institutions like Tavistock to Echelon to Stanford Research and so on, that our society and what even the us that are living amongst the society perceive as them making their own choices is really a very, very, very acute level of social and mental manipulation, because that's what there is. There's the mental world, the real world is the mental world. You know, we open the esoteric text, they tell us everything is mentalism. You know, this is, and what we're doing with our visceral bodies is a great and enormously powerful utility if we harness it. If not, it's totally a slave to the mental memes and prompts put out by these dark magicians. And there's nothing mysterious of them when you get down to it. They just understand the fractals. They understand what we would loosely call symbology. They understand how to optimize sectors. So they're using all these different sacred geometrical, even the term sacred is redundant, they're using geometrical vectors to put things into positions that they wish them to. And if they tap into their Enochian lords and beyond, they can even pause time, swipe back through time, alter a vector that's gone a different way. And it takes immense force of will. One of the reasons I actually very much like the depictions of Satan and the characters Dumbledore or Gandalf, because you really see their primary magic is their will. And the primary force of any magic is will. And that will directed, even say on the visceral level of our temple, our bodies, we're moving through this in, it's a neuromuscular phenomena, which ultimately is an endocrine phenomena. It's us holding our frequency. You know, I know this has been said in some so-called flaky ways so many different times, but it really comes down to us holding our frequency. That when whether it's technotronic waves or whatever you want to call it, that they're coming through and interfering, what they're really doing, as someone who is a TI, has been a TI and had to live through the experience of this perturbance constantly, it's not all that they're doing, but on a technical level, all they're doing is generating a stress vector. And those stress vectors, if they're amped up enough, like currently the pressure's through the roof, that they're to lead you in a way that you wouldn't naturally go. But which is another thing I cut off. I'm saying that the DNA itself, as a representative value of soul, would want to carry itself out according to its pattern. And that's what's being interfered with, because what we have in this great utility, the fiction uninterfered with as human, is the ability to act out a very, very arcane, the most primordial story and repair it. It's almost like you were able to put some very difficult to work on part into a computer mainframe and see or a movie, and you see it in front of you and you're like, okay, there's the problem. It's much more easy to repair. And then we go back to DNA holographically, just fixes everything all the way through. We have that opportunity, but all these little pesky mosquito archons, like the Gnostics would call them, keep nipping and biting. And those are the real demons, the tiny little pesky preoccupations and these elaborate complexes called modern life, which is a non-thing. It's only there because everybody's propelling it on the hamster wheel. It's not a thing to slough off or brush off in a jesting manner that we often do, like, oh, it's modern life, we understand all these sequences of things that people don't really need to be in. It's very, very scary. It's very perilous. It's very precarious to be caught up in these webs, because they are the interference it's automated. All these patterns, even the perpetuators of them don't need to stand on them anymore. Back on a local level, if you go to programs and mind control situations, you don't even need a handler anymore. Everything is digitized. You have all these digitized prompts. You have the local AI, all the nanos that are everywhere. It's all very calculated and systematically run. So all these little pesky preoccupations are not allowing soul code to naturally, organically work itself out.
Yeah, I call these subroutines that are implanted into the data. At some point, there's an algorithm that factors that you've moved off program, and then a subroutine runs, which is self-correcting. It's almost like a behavioral GPS system.
Definitely. That's exactly what it is.
Yeah.
So this comes back to the question you wanted me to elaborate more on. When it comes to practice, you know, it's a very deliberate practice that is something like Zen or something like many of the martial arts. It's there. Everything that we need to embody and be for the change that we need is in our bodies. It must be. And in our interactions with each other and our interactions with all the stimulus that are going on around. And it takes a very high level of discernment to accurately determine that this incoming prompt is something I wish to acknowledge, move forward with, allow to affect me, or just to totally, you don't ever want to push too hard on them, because pushing too hard on them, it's no offense to the animal, the pig, because the pig has been in a very traumatized animal itself, or what it's created for. But it's just like that. There's an expression, you know, when you wrestle with a pig, the pig gets dirty. You know, the pig gets happy, you get dirty.
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm.
So if you wrestle too hard sometimes with a demonic prompt, you're just entangled in its web anyhow. It's a very tricky tightrope walking phenomena that I usually call dancing between the raindrops.
Nice. I like it.
You don't want to get involved with the black magic, you know, because ultimately at the root of all these things, what we have are these very temper tantruming little children. At the root of what the Ektheroi are, these entities, these undifferentiated field, it is a very sort of bratty little child effect. And if you use our metaphors that we're passing through in this fiction, as a parent, you don't want to give the child the ability to control the narrative or the dynamic. And if you allow their temper tantrum, if you interact with the temper tantrum directly instead of wisely, you're just tangled up in that web anyhow.
And yeah, it just kind of becomes self-perpetuating. I've seen this a lot with people who are heavily involved with the occult, on, let's just say, for lack of a better term, the light side, but they're preoccupied with the demonic energies. And a result of that, they're entangling themselves in it, when a lot of times you're dancing between the raindrops or passive resistance of basically being able to deflect, kind of like spiritual jujitsu in a way, using the energetic against itself without actually directly engaging it, is a lot better way to go.
Definitely. I mean, in the ultimate sense, you have to really know what you are capable of, because ultimately it's kind of like we want to kind of be a snake that's devoured. This is the Ouroboros's Ouroboros. Why in the yin yang there would be two Ouroboros's chasing a tail, and which one catches up with which? I'm not. Those who got that. I'm just not even going there. But that there's a layer of this primordial story that I'm intentionally avoiding, because it would just become too elaborate, maybe another time. But it is essentially like, if we use an as above, so below, below, so above, within, so without, so within model, that it's pinocytosis is what we would see it in biology, where a large virus, where a cell allows a large virus to swallow it, then it heals it from the inside out. That's kind of what we're in. That we do want to take on someone almost like an Agoria Sadhu, absorbing the taboo, the deep, the dark, you know, to as much as you're capable of metabolizing. Unfortunately, there are some who dabble either in the occult, or whether it's through drugs or other substances that they're ingesting or becoming involved with, gateways that they're not really ready to handle. And some come out and tell the tale, and some are lost. But ultimately, we do want to take on this darkness into the vessel and metabolize it into a form where the undifferentiated field becomes differentiated and is granted a soul. Now I'm getting really into it. So that's the correction. That's the correction that the very, very few elite who are passing through that narrow, narrow, narrow gate would hear and know how to handle. But generally speaking, passing through everyday life is a more, like you said, is a common phase of deflection, because most of the things that are coming at are not worth our time. They're just there to distract and to get you entangled with them. But the main tab that we're on is practice. The practice is that it's not just knowing, you know, on a very left brain or even somewhat creative way, but it's not a cerebral thing where you know that there are strange agencies out there, and there's the Illuminati and the Illuminati and all these different things, and, you know, watching the next segment come out to figure out what's going to happen. That it's far more of a very natural process of life where you can identify stimulus and prompts that are coming towards you and that you are then going to put out as being clean or not, things you want to pick up and move with or interact with. And sometimes it can become very, very literal. Like, do I want to move my body now, or am I going to pick up a nail in the tire? Because there's these black, I keep using this term, black magic, but they're just vectors. Somebody's dropped a spell. Somebody's dropped a vector in the area. You know, it takes up mass. It takes up, it has a place in the geography. And if you turn your ship into it, you know, your vessel, your body, you could pass through and pick one of your organs. You know, this is the great alchemy, the real alchemy, the alchemy of the body. You could pass through and suddenly pick up an attachment. If you go back to getting a viral attachment, a nail in the tire, something you don't really want. You know, so there's great care at moving through everyday life. However, this looks very dysfunctional, becomes very challenging because we're in this massive hustle, the hassle of all these conventions that are running around us. Again, but that's back to all these inane processes using, you know, taking up CPU, RAM, or whatever.
So I guess where we go from here is recognizing, first off, this particular aspect, the aspect that goes into the quickening, because this message is going to resonate with some people. It's going to repel other people. And there's going to be people who are going to kind of be somewhere in the middle of that continuum. They want to know how to identify themselves, and then from there to begin to identify the others. And the reason why this is important is because I've said that we're not doing this consciously. We can't create the architecture to join strategic groups of people, souls, spirits. This is actually being done outside of space and time, and it is being controlled by higher intelligence. So what do we recognize within ourselves, and then how do we recognize within others?
Well, on the most simple level, if I were to answer that, I would say those asking that question...
You actually are answering that.
those asking that question probably... if you're asking the question, you probably are part of the process. You probably wouldn't be sitting there doubting, am I? Am I not? Like, who would even care? If you're asking that question, you're probably part of the process. Now, you know, that may not disqualify you from being crazy, too. I mean, maybe you're also crazy. So, you know, if you're asking
I think thinking you're crazy is actually part of the process.
I'm sure. Well, I mean, that's part of our meme. That's part of our social, you know, the memes that have been entrenched within all the ritual programming for thousands of years and possibly hundreds of aeons or billions of aeons or whatever, is, you know, to be confused and feel inadequate, to feel self-doubt, to feel isolated, alone. But if you come into these things and give them any confirmation, you know, we live in a culture, Randy, obviously, that the term I would use, it needs to reify itself. It needs to constantly, this is something we talked about when I was with you a month ago, or whatever it was, that, you know, everybody's looking for the details. Show me that it's actually a thing, as opposed to actually entering back into the interior core of what you and I would know what remote viewing really is, to go into an intuitive, beyond right brain, beyond any kind of right brain mode, a really intuitive core of knowing from within yourself. And it's not, you know, it's the anathematic antithesis of solipsism. It's just a pure on gnosis or doth. You just know because you do. And that, you know, anybody who wants any kind of confirmation on something just went crazy because I said that. I just discredited everything else because, well, how do we know? How do we, you know, because you know. And you know because you are.
You know because you know, and you know because you've worked through the dissonance enough to be able to get to the place where you know, because there's no other possible conclusion. Which then goes into the others. When I say others, I'm saying component parts of something that's actually a whole in itself. And we've talked about the Netflix TV series Sense8, which I think is actually a very interesting structure, but you had the groups that were being pulled together. They were beginning to experience a blurring of reality. And a lot of this is drama as well. But interacting on a psychic level with each other, accidentally stepping into each other's reality streams. Well, that's a dramatic representation of a very real process that's going on, of how we wind up bleeding over into another reality or being bled into.
I really like that language of the bleed through. That's certainly what it is. It is certainly a bleed through. And we are flowing through each other. But we maintain our individuality also, which is a neat thing that's able to be represented in that series. They all are their uniquely individual, but there's a homogeneous field that's being threaded through them. And they can access each other's abilities and knowledge and strengths and qualities also, which is interesting. They can draw off each other as they need. You know, and somehow within that is, again, back to Nietzsche's term of eternal recurrence. When you ask the question, how to identify, am I, do you want to be? The question isn't as much as, are you, as do you want to be? Now, again, this will probably drive the fundamentalist natural law folks crazy, but there isn't any. Do you want to be? Because there's a role that's waiting for you. You have the potential to be it, but you must step into it. It's tricky, but the question somehow is, do you want to be? Do you want to be part of it? Do you want to write yourself into the story in an effective way that you helped heal everything? Well, then in some non-Calvinist, non-deterministic kind of way, you were always part of it, because there's only now. And I guess we could sort of look at the again, if we go back to these movie references, Cloud Atlas, that we were just talking about. There's all these layers happening at the same time. All these layers of ourselves, which is sometimes why it's so hard in Midgard, in this central role that we're walking through currently. Sometimes lately it's hard to move because we're dragging all these layers. Sometimes we're dragging all these others along with us. Not sure which direction to turn our head. Because if you see the sting, the butterfly effect is different than if you turn that way and saw that thing. And even if you're not aware that you're doing that, you might be doing that. You might be cautiously making every move currently. Which is not to say not to live flowing, but again, just cautiously aware, more and more mindful of these streams that are coming through. And that we have the ability, because that great intelligence that you spoke of really is ourselves. It really is a much more abstracted, I guess I could use that term, form of ourselves in collusion with each other, where there's clarity, guiding this process in here. I want to use that reference. I don't know how we want to relate to our vectors, but in this fiction, to carefully align with the real world that we are guiding destiny. And I guess that's it, but it may seem, even to some of us, you know, what could be simplified to being grandiose. But it's not. Anybody who can really hear these messages, they're part of you. We're seeking you. We're all seeking each other. It's not grandiose. It's our legacy. And we shouldn't downplay that, but rather integrate it and ground it to this fiction. You know, it's again, I'm going to go back, and I know I mentioned the great avatar Yeshua in the beginning. I'm going to reference him again. He said, the kingdom of heaven is before you this very day if you but seize hold of it. It's a very misunderstood and extremely powerful statement that this so-called, this entity, this experience that I've been referring to as the fiction I said originally in the introduction, is a leading fictional lives in a non-fiction. And what some of the ancient Midrash would call the Atid Lavo, the not the world to come, not the eternal destiny, but rather it's a hallway to it, the age to come. And in that time, we formulate what we want to be. And we've heard this from, you know, one expression of some galactic entity to the Mayans here, and everybody has their way of putting it. The indigenous, the aboriginals, the ancient Northern European forms, African tribe, whoever it is, there's a way of understanding that we're in a very particular instance in which we can shape where things are going. And we just have to maintain a certain dexterity to be willing to keep upgrading and seeing more clearly how much responsibility we have, because it's kind of ultimately it. If we were to use the analogy of the body, there are superior and inferior parts, but an inferior part is no less necessary. We have, again, psychological complexes in this modern world that have been intentionally anchored in, where in a duality program, a multi-pluralistic program, everybody wants to be special, and, you know, and everybody is special. But everybody has a role. So the role of a capillary is to be a great capillary, not to attempt to interfere and be a brain. There's a part in the esoteric body of being for everybody. It's just to have the openness and dexterity to discover the role. And again, there are plenty of us who could fall into these left brain linearizations of such a thing, and then they're looking for their role, like, what's my role, to be this or that? And that's not what it means.
No, because ultimately, in the flowing together of all this, the roles are fluid. You know, again, yeah, that kind of goes back to Sensei, by the way. That is very clear, where they begin to actually, you know, again, you've got to think somewhat metaphorically, but they were able to transfer abilities from one person to another as was required. So basically, you're almost like a module that's plugged in, and each module has the capabilities of the other modules to whatever degree is required.
Almost, huh?
Almost.
You're saying it's almost like that. It's almost like everyone's jacked into each other, or it's just like that. There's another little movie reference, a more obscure movie called Existence, with a Z. There's this game system, and like there's a creator of this game system that everybody's jacking themselves into. They literally get a port in their back. Mm-hmm. And the game system itself is alive. They're making it out of these like living animal parts, and it takes on a kind of consciousness, and they're all inside. And then it's very, there's a literary term for the progression of the movie, but then it sort of flips on itself and has another layer. It's very compelling. But this is where we are at, that if you begin to enter the real world, the mental world, the physical world, where physics are composed, and you're on the game board, but you don't have charge. So there's a different faction that's in charge that's running the game board. This is very scary. It's very threatening on a neurological level, because they're casting things at you, like throwing stones, like they're literally casting things at you, you know, or casting a schema, a script, scenarios. You can bring it down to the local lives. We have these so-called green birds. These other entities that, you know, are connected to a very socially, you know, again, if you play inside the fiction, this 9/11 event, you know, and altered, you know, right to Sandy Hook, maybe even in Paris. What do I know? I have no idea about Paris. I'm not speaking for that. But, you know, we have these ones that we've all sifted through. We know there are this little tribe of malevolent, malignant characters, these Greenbergs that are in these high entities, and they're going to trace back to these Aryans, real Aryans, the children of Mars. And this is, again, opening big Pandora's boxes to Atlantis and before, and so on and so on. But they're around, and then you have sublets of actors that literally play scenarios in our life on this fictional game board, and those have to be noticed too, and that's a whole other diatribe of its own. And, you know, they're it's sort of an amusement park in a zoo full of hodgepodge nonsense. And, you know, and at one moment it's kind of hilarious, they're obnoxious stunts, and then at another moment it's hellishly precarious. And in the middle of it, we're supposed to, I use the term gray walk, gap stand, and just be in our center and our cores and pass through it. Walking through the raindrops. I mean, there's more that could be said about any of these topics. There's more directions they could all go, but they all come back to us holding our center, and you know, and knowing that while the details are instructive, they're not the thing itself.
So somewhere in all of this, there always lurks an enemy, and. I've had a couple of conversations with other people that, you know, again, there's a lot of overlap in conversations that I have with different people who don't know each other. But one of the things that we're seeing now is that even as these cells, these groups are starting to come together, there seems to be also an attempt to hijack them. And this is really true in social media on the internet, where we're beginning to see a lot of people that are either, let us just say, not what they appear to be, or they are operating under some agency in order to become collectors or harvesters of the genuine souls who are to function in this whole gathering process, this whole quickening. And they're attempting to hijack the process.
Yes.
And this is a big concern right now. And I've talked about this, you know, pretty openly, but I've addressed it on a broader scale of largely being, you know, this whole COINTEL disinfo type thing that we see with certain what I consider to be agents out there. But when you get to the level of hijacking what is effectively groups of people that are strategic to this level of operation, then it gets a bit more nefarious. Do you want to address that at all? What's going on with that?
Yeah. It's, you know, it's again, okay, you started this idea, this question, this query concerning an enemy.
Or a usurper.
And, no, it's fine. The term is fine. It's always a redirection, and I don't mean this in any light, literally light isn't light, or light isn't trite manner of saying it, but it's always within ourselves that, and I don't just mean our like local my me, I mean the us. They're okay. I've used this little mini diatribe to say it to people. A garbage collector is going to collect garbage if he's doing his job. School teacher is going to teach school if they're doing their job. A little baby, when it's born, is only capable to expend its energy pretty much of crying and maybe relieving itself and eating. It needs to do these things to expend its energy so it can sleep, so it can grow. That's pretty much what it's going to do. These entities that have put themselves in limbo, that were part of the primordial era of jumping into the field of separation, which I could elaborate on forever, literally, they are at various levels and phases demons. Let me say emphatically, as anathematic as it may sound, they're not the enemy. The enemy, in the most, summarized form of, put it with as great a brevity as I can, the enemy is apathy within ourselves. The enemy is self-doubt. The enemy is not staying attuned to spirit. The enemy is all the qualities within ourselves that we would not overcome to actualize our being, to trust what may seem like all these, all these contrivances, the DSM-6 is coming out and it has in it a condition called orthorexia nervosa. You want to eat healthy all the time. That's a disorder. There are these ridiculous forms of contrivances from there to in law, in legalities. And if we succumb to giving them any formidability, if we succumb to giving them any legitimacy, any credence, any weight, and not staying with our centered sureties, all these qualities are the enemy. All these qualities are the most powerful beings being bitten by little mosquito archons of confusion.
Let me try and frame that. Your greatest strength will be the greatest weakness deployed against you.
Of course, that's what we see, whether it be on these very, very local levels of some surface FBI people, to your friends prompted by social trends, to deeper shadow agencies, to whatever layer of infiltration, straight back to some primordial goo, whatever it is, they're going to hit you at your weak point and let you doubt or relinquish your surety of your strength, because the adversaries employ confusion and obfuscation. And they can come forward. We have heroes in the alternative media world who are filled with demonic attachments. Their messages are almost, but they, if you set your GPS or some other device on a trajectory that's like 3 degrees off, and you're intending to end up in San Diego, you could end up in Oregon, but if they're coming off the East Coast of the United States. These slightly askew heroes in the alternative world can lead people to some really off-kilter places. And of course, they're the first jury to come out and describe a more magical message as having drank the Kool-Aid and being ungrounded. An attempt to hope of some more. Either on one end, they're going to be more down to earth and pushing probably things that trend into the more aggressive, I guess. I'm not entirely not with that, but the side of activism that's more combatant might be a word, or it's just going to be some really extravagant and exotic sounding BS, one direction or the other. But they're not really helpful. But then we don't need to sit around and fault them. We need to overcome our mind's interest in fueling those who are promulgating this nonsense. If we were informing ourselves from our centers, there's large volumes of information that I could say that all these people have also said, but Mike, what value is my contribution if it's not toward talking about these things that interest us all in some sort of natural way, because many of us have at the core of our narrative in this fiction that we've been birthed through and we've been living in for these so-called years of our lives, we have been in connection to these things. We've been those who in some cases as children, we made the framework that those who were utilizing our talents, they that's our stuff. It's almost like those are our babies. Those are our, those, you know, and we're linked to this reality. But at the same time, we can't get caught up in it. And we have to stay with our center. So my activity of speaking about these various cults and procedures and programs, things I've been through, things that many of us have been through, some of us remember more, some of us remember less, some are still in amnesia or alters and compartmentalization and denial or whatever else, it's more than an anchor. It's a placeholder that you know, it resonates, but it's not about those things. We were the correct use of the word. We were involved in those things because of who we are when we came here. They didn't make us. They used us because of what we were. So it's always, you know, knowing that it's like, you know, we're part of an interesting little group of, you know, of a niche of a kind amongst the peripheral layers of existence. But it's not to get caught up in those things themselves, but rather why those agencies were interested in us to begin with, because of who we are, and we need to stay with our center and to come from that place. You know, that's you know, my contribution to all of this is being myself and attracting those who are themselves, not just out there putting out details, whether correct or real, accurate or not, are just ultimately going to just be triggering more deep layers of mind-controlled folks, program folks, and cult folks to go on other hamster wheels. Not here to add more confusion. Not even, you know, for me to add others' clarity, but rather just a connection. That there's a check-in place that we can build called home, you know, where we can come together.
And right now it doesn't feel like that really is happening. You know, we've talked about this, that physically there's no real place for us to be. And that even virtually, if you just look at the internet, it's very difficult. And then we occupy a space in, I don't know, astral, the spirit realms.
Sure.
And the psychic realms, certainly. And that's where we have to optimize right now. But ultimately, is there a gathering? I mean, is there a way that these disparate cells come together to operate in some meaningful fashion?
Well, I would say not. I would say there must be. If we are to achieve some so-called victory, like let's say you and I, those who have been code crackers, let's call it that, puzzle pieces of the puzzle together, taking apart these weird strands of things, you know, and others who've contributed, whether they've been co-opted or they're still on or they were never on, or, you know, you can learn things from the darkest of magicians I've found sometimes have the simplest clarity that you can then feed back through. Wherever it is, there are those who are still coming in that, you know, it really ends up being very simple. I mean, this is very tribal. We are ultimately a tribe. I'd say we're a different species. You know, it's getting to a whole nother concourse of junctures and layers, but there was, you know, if you talk about the autumn cosmos way beyond any of the atomic creatures here, if you go back to some, there's a different seed, if you will, there's a different species. These words don't hold it, but there's a, you know, and that's who we're reaching out to. I mean, ultimately, again, anything I've said can just sound somewhat empty or just strange, you know, as a word, to watch anybody listening who's not tuning into the frequency I'm generating. It's just, I haven't really said much of anything. I didn't even really get into telling my story, which I planned to, but it didn't go that. So taking its direction here. But there's needs to be a geographical coming together of those. It's to form a battery. But it's also putting out that call, which is the message, that's the consistent message I've been spreading for 20 years, is there needs to be a geographical gathering there needs to be a geographical quickening because we're in the fiction. And since we're in the fiction, we need to use what Yeshua said, what the so-called Jesus said. You know, this is the kingdom of heaven is here. It's in these things to restore the true, the actual spirit world, spiritual world. It's going to take having the alchemy of the body set, eating what the body needs to reach mental clarity. It's going to take living in harmony and community. It's going to take the thing is not to get caught up in those things themselves, but when there is this kind of functionality on this earth plane, then we will experience a quantum jump to the next level where the vector has turned from hurtling itself into further separation. That's what I take on, that this generation's job is simply to turn vectors that have been hurtling themselves at separation for so long and turn them back towards cohesion. Because that's will. In choice, in layer of intentionality of choice, there is, you know, what would seem to be endless choice. Vast options. But in will is either you're moving, you're acting towards separation or you're acting towards cohesion. And there's been such a trend towards separation in all of existence.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
That the Kabbalists, the esoterists, would call this the 150th gate. We're at a point where if things move beyond this, you know, in the Vedic culture, they see Shiva Shakti that is destroyed and rebuilt so many times. If we look at these as some kind of malignant, delirious children, they're just on a temper tantrum. They keep destroying and recreating every time they get upset with one layer of the matrix, almost like archetype of the engine, the architect in the Matrix movies, you know, your predecessors rebuild it, destroy it, rebuild it. That has a threshold. That is a threshold that the delirious entities are not looking at, which is why they will never attain oblivion, but rather they'll say shattering. They say originally in the refined Kabbalah, it doesn't see this like the Jewish Kabbalah sees this as a positive thing that God has set in motion. But striking that aside, in the refined Kabbalah, this is just a shattering. It's just a shattering. Shattering does not sound positive. It's just these fractals are seemingly on a separational trajectory of just shattering and shattering. If they go past a certain point, they will be beyond repair. They will no longer be able to be paired back together. And I see our generation's task, our mission, our duty here is to defuse, discharge a ton of these so-called inorganic, archontic little nodes everywhere through our daily lives as we're walking them out, home the vector back toward cohesion. That is our task. And there will be a path that will then ensue with our literal children and their children, and we'll be coming back along those genetic lines, as it always is a soul, that will continue to rarefy and refine itself back towards being a spirit, the real spiritual world will slowly emanate back into existence. But this is what they call the thousand-year reign, the golden age, all these different terminologies. But it's nothing that's just going to save your pat programming. It's nothing that's going to just poof, you know, magic just appear. It's from our work in holding this space of integrity and coming together and doing these pragmatic, harmonious, so-called sustainable things on the earth that we see in this fiction, because we're telling, you know, loosely put Gaia consciousness, some integral consciousness, we're saying we want the path of harmony to come forward. We throw down pragmatically toward that. We're instructing the very fabric of our existence to go back along that path. Were we to know where we are, that we are the keynote, everything is watching us. You know, again, there's New Age ways of saying this, but everything is literally being impacted by the core. We're in the core. We're in Midgard. We're in the core. Everything is being impacted by what we do here. And if we take that path of bringing things to a harmony of reverence, of connection with each other and with nature and with everything flowing in a healed health path, it's going to ripple everywhere, and we will start to turn the vector towards cohesion. That is our task, and it's what may be romanticized as some version, you know, vision of tribal living of say before monochromatic time, going back into a polychromatic dream time where there's everyone flowing together and working. I'm not sure that that ever really existed in this matrix, or if it's just a holdover from others. But whatever that romanticizes, it's something like that.
Say that again. Say that again. The what? The poly.
We live in monochromatic time.
Yes.
You know, they call it the Aboriginals call it the error in time. You know, when time is, you know, if we can merge back into polychromatic time, where we live in dream time. I'm also not sure that was ever actually a thing. I'm not sure if that was ever real. We have some. I'm not sure how much of our history really happened inside of this matrix, or if it's a holdover. It's really irrelevant at the end of the day. But whatever we can envision of that kind of, even if it's just a romanticized or imagined to some extent, but I'd rather say dreamed, visualized version of that, that's what we need. We, you know, we probably need, I would say definitely need, a ton of the AI that we've created, we've generated just in, it all needs to be integrated. You know, the pushing away of the silicon soul is also an error. We need to integrate that, but we need to integrate that. We who have, again, when it goes back to the model of the body, this is going to, you know, scandalize anybody I haven't probably yet who's not totally us. We need to rule this world. We totally need to step up and rule this world, because all the layers need to be ruled. Until we really re-enter spiritual world, there is hierarchy because of the primordial error. There is not ultimately meant to be. It's ultimately meant to be a total homogeneity. But currently, and this is where I was going with the fact that not all things are necessary, all parts are necessary, be they a capillary or the brain, not all parts are superior, some are inferior. But that, in our society, that would imply a less than. The capillary is less than the brain. That is incorrect. That is a fallacious conflation. If you took a building with a screw that and whatever buttressings that held a central column in place, they're just as necessary as the central column itself. They may be an inferior part, but they're all necessary. Every part is necessary. And actually, when a part is doing what its function is, it is totally happy. Totally happy. And that flies in the face of all modernity and all progressive ideas, but is actually correct and simple. And when, you know, if you use the model of the body, a capillary, a little part of an organelle may be inferior to, say, greater functional organs and parts. It doesn't make them less than. They're not, nothing is less than. Nothing is greater than. And the parts that are superior in a corrected reality are more responsible. So again, you know, this Jesus theme plays through our reality in so many different ways. There's the old, I believe somebody said it before, L. Ron Hubbard, but people, gotta say his name
right. I hope so.
But he said, you know, the old madman or messiah thing about Jesus. Many of you have used it. But this is actually an inane query. It's an inane questioning, because when the corrected model or the corrected reality is brought in of the body, the parts that, getting back again to Nietzsche's either metempsychosis, that was originally introduced by Plato, I believe, it actually goes back to Pythagoras, beyond the concept there's this Gilgul transmigration, and rolling into the concept of eternal recurrence and stepping into roles. And when you step up to a superior position, that position is for the sake of total service and responsibility. So it's not a question of madman or messiah. You know, it's a question of idiot or messiah.
Do we have the
awareness of what a messiah is? You're taking on greater responsibility to the collective body of everybody and making sure that a capillary gets exactly what a capillary needs, a kidney gets exactly what a kidney and its nephrons need, and a lung gets what a lung needs, and its alveoli get what they need. Each component is exactly balanced with what it needs, which is exactly axiomatically antithetical to the way the so-called elite out to these X-rays on everything, which is called lack. It's like what a parasite does. Destroy the very thing that they're living on.
Yeah.
You know, the terminology of louche, suck the energy away from the very body that's supporting them. This is delirious.
Well, that's what we have on the planet right now. We have a parasitic governmental structure that is basically collapsing the very structure that supports it itself. It's a top-down system that consumes everything in sight. It's kind of like the Borg.
It is, but that's a blessing. It's actually a blessing because it gives us an opportunity because it's as above, so below. We can. It's showing itself. It's a symptomatic representation of the disease in all existence. That there is, you know, it's something to strikingly stand that everything is not well. Everything is not okay. Through all, they couldn't be like this here if there was some great savior action about to happen upon us and just take care of everything for, like, that's absurd. The reason our governments are acting themselves out, the reason the so-called cults, all the layers of this are able to do that is because that's what existence is full of. And our job is to step forward and realize we are the ones we've been waiting for, to use that cliche phrase, but it's real. We are the ones we've been waiting for. I heard to say things like Mary Angelou, and not that I'm... Not that I'm giving any, approbation to these to the Course in Miracles, but she brought down a powerful anonymous quote. You know, I'm going to paraphrase it, maybe ruin it, but you know, you can look it up yourself. It says that shrinking yourself doesn't serve others. You know, restricting your light so you kind of don't step on other people's toes, not shining in the fullness of your grace. So that this is not productive. You know, again, this could tiptoe into certain things that terrible echelon culture in the 60s, you know, when they usurped the revolution, as they called it, literally turned it into a turning back around. But, you know, I knew some of those who were part of what was really very akin to what the Avatar Yeshua was doing with his Essene group, as we know from the scriptures, the Nag Hammadi text. Shouldn't really call them scriptures, but whatever, they're scriptures, yes, classic, no, but anyway, what was going on in the 60s was far more originally akin to that before these various agencies stepped in and turned it. That,
well, that actually was, you would say, without, you know, getting too cliched about it, the dawning of the age of Aquarius. I mean, that was the seeds that were sown, because I think we saw what we would call indigo, star seeds, whatever, you know, unfortunate term, but they were coming in that particular period. I mean, from 1947 forward, it seems like there were just wave after wave of...
Sure, so the portal, Stargate, a gate, I don't want to call it exactly a Stargate, but there was a gate that was...
I don't think it's an accident that ascendant with that was the fact that you then begin to have all these mind control operations and all of this sophisticated harvesting that began to go on. I mean, why is it that the people who have gone through the most amount of traumatic abuse are some of the most, these seem to be the people that are the most awakened and being called into action in what we're talking about, in the context of what we're talking about. It seems like trauma has almost become the catapult to energetically leap a lot of these people into their calling.
It's interesting because it's almost not, it's as perverse as it is.
It's an inverse action. Yeah.
It's a crucible. It's a kind of crucible.
Yeah.
It's giving us our power in a way. It's very perverse. We live in a very perverse world. You couldn't preach this stuff on a clean, dynamic platform to a classroom. You know, if we had a real linear world, you couldn't preach this to a classroom full of, you know, clean souls. But in a way, we kind of need this to send us into our power, to sort of take. I'm going to mention, I know there hasn't been an elaboration from Duncan Afinian, but he's mentioned this, and I know very well what it means, that on the level of the programs, they believed that they were exploiting us, and the technical truth, the technical fact is we've been exploiting them. Because being the third tier of the anomaly, there's a whole bunch of stuff that they're going to have to find out, you know, as those who are not on the level of what our mutual friend called parents. You know, they're these bloodlines that are running experimentational programs, and they're, you know, as Jay Parker said, they're being thrown under the bus.
Well, they had looking glass technology. They had what is effectively a very sophisticated scrying that could look into the time streams. And like I said, it wasn't an accident that those programs began concurrent with this generation, this wave coming in. This was part of what they knew and what they saw. And
we don't know. we don't know ultimately what past and future is. And if I were to make such an outlandish statement, I would say our existence began somewhere around 1910, and everything else was backtracked.
Of course, yeah, and that goes right along with the whole thing. You know, it's just simply...
Well, we would call in our fiction, we would call it 1910. Somewhere between 1910 and 1950, existence really began, and then everything else spiraled out from there. But that sounds really weird to anybody who doesn't have a concept of what...
Right, because we're hooked into linear time. We don't...
That's where this giant bass really starts spooling out its water. I'm not going any further with that. I just wanted to put on the ground again, put the feedback on the ground before this goes any further into that for now, that in terms of the 60s and what was put out as regards shrinking yourself and somewhat back to that question of identifying ourselves, there is a stream which of course threads back to that early 1900s and the Theosophical Society, what they've fooled through mainstream religions and even secular self-help and self-improvement and be a better individual type stuff. It's everywhere and in the new age. And it's like in that thread, it's nice guy culture. And in terms of the 60s, what we have promulgated largely by the Grateful Dead, Garcia, who's known to be in, you know, with these in McKenna and all these people thought it felt like it was a good idea to do this, you know, dark occult work or whatever you want to call it, that they produced a very, very twisted notion of humility. And their twisted notion of humility became what I would loosely call diminishment culture. Diminish yourself. That the aim of these people to fulfill what really is a very Agenda 21 type program to get real lowly and to diminish themselves and to fall into Mother Earth. I'm going to defend pagan. That's fine. I'm fine doing that. I'm not talking about those who understood the harmony of working with nature like shaman. That's not what I'm talking about. I'm talking about people who worship nature and fall into a victimization. And that was very much one of the memes that went around hippie culture. And then in the bands and in bands like the Dead, that was originally called the Warlocks, of course, they were promulgating a very twisted notion of humility. When humility is understood as what it means transparency, the ability to see the self, the full self, as it actually is, not to shrink yourself, not to tiptoe around, to let, again, we'll use our cliche words, to let your light shine, to be what you are.
Yeah, we actually kind of touched on this, but you refined it by going on into that, the humility aspect of it, the faux humility. But really, in a sense, if you're fully engaged in your energetic, it is going to assert itself through you. That's different than egoistically engaging it. So that at the appropriate times, you know when to step back and step back or step forward into the role that you're supposed to occupy. That goes, you know, kind of back into how the groups themselves function energetically and being able to fluidly move in and out of, well, the bleed through the use of different consciousness and different gifts. Because if you deprecate yourself, you've basically diminished your capacity. And if you elevate mm-hmm. yourself, you then become the parasitic.
Yeah, and we have this in all the religions, all the mainstream religions or substream religions. Nice guy, call it nice guy culture. That you're not, that if you get too, you know, prophetically, you know, righteous indignation, and you're on the mark, you're not just off kilter. That we have this is not okay. This is, and all the mainstream religions are gonna, you know, they're gonna push us away, or in regular culture, you're gonna be deemed psychotic. And there's all these ways to handle. There's all these little handlers. There's all these little substructure sets of statute and stipulation subconscious meme or way that these religions run, that, you know, say if it were a Christian church, they don't, you know, there's only a certain context we're going to talk about demons. It's not necessarily the one Yeshua talked about them in. You know, the truly actually stepping into full power is discouraged, talked about in all these different subsets, but discouraged from actually being done. Only up to here. only up to here. And then you don't want to offend everybody. You know, you don't want to overshadow everybody. So please restrain your talent, which is not the same as honing your talent. And we have this on all these levels, from the Theosophical Society weaving this meme into all these, you know, the modern versions of mainstream religions, or, you know, coming into, so you have a great awakening happening in the 60s. Well, you got to curtail that, you know, with this diminishment. But knowing when and where and how is back to that stepping into that fullness of responsibility. You know, it's generating for us, again, what might be called an eldership, if we were back to being a tribal people, or into being, moving into. And I'm not sure if these aboriginals aren't actually from the future. You know, there's a potential future of what we could become, moving into that flow again. But again, that's the tricky stuff of what we're looking at. But the message should be pretty saliently discernible to what I've said, that, you know, we need cohesion. We need cohesion with each other. And we need cohesion. It was sitting there, but it wasn't explicitly said by either of us. But we need to know ourselves, and we need to have cohesion with ourselves as well. The great esoteric systems said, "Know thyself." That is the whole. You know. It might have been Jung who said, you know, one of them said, you know, Nietzsche knew himself better than any human living. Kind of wild thing to say. But, it, you know, it's really dropping through the rabbit holes of the mind, and that's being put through these traumas that themselves are terrible, but then also they form the crucible. That puts us through the initiations in order to be responsible for healing, which is, again, why I'm saying these dark entities, these demons, are not the enemy. The enemy is apathetic or disempowered versions of us who are laying around not doing their work. That's the enemy. The enemy is when we don't do our work. The enemy is when our work isn't being done for seva, for service to the, for real service to all beings. What in that could be very, must be very, it must be for those who have the most refined frequency and the greatest responsibility, the highest superiority of doing this work, kind of like the core of a neutron bomb. You know, you have to start at the core and it ripples out and ripples out. And to not acknowledge that when you're carrying that is to be the enemy. You're not doing your work. That's the enemy. You know, we can get distracted by the darkness, the so-called darkness. But again, it's just a really bratty child. And at the end of the day, the deepest dark, you know, shadow layer is just that. It's a shadow. These are the undifferentiated field. And if we were to use the analogy of little children, they need to be picked up, spanked, hugged, and put to bed so the parents can come back and run the ship. Because currently it looks like there's a bunch of children who lock the parents out of the house and they're breaking everything and laughing. And the parents are just standing around astonished outside, like, what do we do? Well, you know, you find something, you break the glass, you come inside, you take the knives away from the kids, and you discipline them, and you put them to bed, and you train them better tomorrow, and you make some foolproof systems, not get locked out of the house next time. We don't stand around with our mouths agape like, oh no, they're ruining everything.
Yeah, I always, you always, when you say that, I get the cat in the hat, but I know that's not the perfect metaphor for it, but it's what I get.
Pretty decent.
You know, it kind of is. I mean, on one level, we've really in a lot of ways been unruly children as a race, and even many among us that are trying to tap into what we're supposed to do right now get caught up in this. Okay, so here's the thing. You said, this may nutshell a couple of things. You've said we need to be like the Illuminati, just not evil. Meaning, and it is, you know, you said that, you said that to me. Yeah, you said that to me, but it was a great quote because it's true. I mean, it's, you know,
again, I keep quoting our mutual friend there, and he knows who he is, and he probably listened to this, but as he would put it, things that are not for casual eyes. This is not for casual ears.
No, it's not. So somebody will hear that statement.
I'm sure anybody who's made it this deep into our talk can go ahead and say that this would be represented by the archetype of the patriarch Jacob, Yaakov, that when he was with the archetypal character Laban, the Aramean, it's represented as this... I called it the Jacobian principle for a long time, but I don't even want to say that because it has nothing to do with the local history version of the Jacobians in Britain.
Yeah, that has a lot of baggage.
And I mean, a principle of the patriarch, the archetypal individual Jacob in the Book of Genesis. What he came to is, and I've been threading it through here. And again, this is going to drive the natural laws crazy, but ultimately, when you know. And you know, and you're really centered, and you must be very, very authentic and honest and clear. Expedience currently is the most potent and useful form of activity. Wow, okay, there you go, I did it. That's really, really dangerous to put out there, and I did. But a kind of expedience where we must take, okay, here we go, here's a way I can put it back on their side. Brain mapping. Okay, when they're using nano to do brain mapping, it's a by the instant, I mean the literal seconds of, in the fiction, in the relative world that we're living in. They're adapting, they're fluxing, and we need to outdo them at their own game. Again, we are parents, we are progenitors, we are originals, and those of us who know, and we have this in us, and I'm chuckling a little, and sometimes I get to this point when I feel resonance with others who get it, but it's not funny. It's really not funny. It's simple, but it's not easy. This task is a great and mighty work that takes a severe amount of reverence and application. It has a hilarious a levitous side to it because of the way that it propagates into our everyday lives. And this twisted confusion is a circus of zoo animals just running around, and it's nonsense. But that nonsense, you know, if you had a literal circus of zoo animals running around, that would be really dangerous. So even though we can see all the archetypal agencies and characters and entities going around, and you can laugh at them at a certain, because they are nonsensical and in a certain tense adorable and ridiculous, at the same time, if a circus full of animals of a zoo or whatever or farm broke out and was running around, or you're suddenly in the middle of a jungle of interesting animals, that's also very scary and dangerous. And that's what we're wading through.
So is there anywhere else we need to go with this? Is there anything we haven't covered so far, or is there some other points that you want to cover at this point, Z?
Nothing's, I'm sure there are, and I'm sure that there were a million different ways I could have said these things, the things that I could have held on to more at certain points to elucidate.
Well, you've been remarkably consistent in saying them, because this recording today is a synopsis of conversations you and I have been having for over a year now, and the result of a face-to-face meeting as well. And, you know, I think the themes are all present here. I think the threads are all fairly well connected. And I think you've been very consistent in what you've put out. And it's not, first off, this is not for the consumption of those who simply want to listen to things and consume information, but it is encoded information. And so, by the very nature of the content and the form that we're using to do this, there are people who are not going to get it. There are people who are going to hate this show. And there are people who are going to have to go back and listen to it and find the threads of the message that, holographically kind of connect to their own resonance patterns.
Yes, I am. These words are a beacon. That's what they are. And I guess I would wrap up that principle of the archetype of Jacob was saying, this is to them in their design fiction a game. We must play the game, but we must know emphatically, piercingly, at every instant, that it is not a game. that the game is not a game and the fiction is not fiction, and that everything that is occurring that we do when we put our intentionality and our will forth to is going to yield our destiny. This is our legacy. We are built to do this. There's no need to get paranoid or fearful. Forget you're even there. At a certain level, forget you're even there. Your job is to be the best, most powerful, most bright you that you can be for the sake of every being else, every other being. It's not about you toning yourself down. It's about you amplifying yourself up and stepping and seizing power, because power is far greater than love. Sorry to tell everybody, love is a really, really simple force. Love is an outgoing force. Love is, when we look at the words, the semantics of love, love is a channel out that you give or put out to another that you care at. Power is far more important than love, because without power, you cannot love. The greatest force of all is beauty. When we start to do acts of love that form a feedbacking loop, they will generate harmony, but that can't be done without seizing power. And it's our time. It's our time to responsibly seize power and to direct the flow manifest, so that those super intelligent parts of ourselves that we're talking about fully come in here and start parentally guiding. I don't want to say running, even anything that sounds like guiding everything here, like a well-integrated parent will do. And when they come in, they know this isn't a game. This is an eternal path to our destiny. This is our legacy to do it. We are built to do it. We need to stay focused to step into the roles to bring it to be. It's also when you're flowing, when things are interfering, it's the most natural thing. It's just the natural course of things, because we created ourselves for this reason. This is why existence came into being, was to become what we are.
Perfect. That's actually, I think, the perfect way to summarize this this recording today, Z. And you know, of course, that as time passes on and there are other messages that need to go out, that we're here to facilitate that, and you're welcome to come back anytime. You know how that works. And for those of you out there who are hearing this, again, you know, it's going to require the resonance patterns to fully engage, and then parcel through this and find out what it means to you, and then start to step up. If you need to connect, those connections will present themselves in the appropriate ways and at the most fortuitous time. We're going to end this conversation here with what we usually say: the truth is out there. It's inside of you. Now pick up the mantle and start walking with it. I'm Randy Moggins for Off Planet Radio.
This is Off Planet Radio.
Searching for. The truth is in you.